knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we discussed a number of immunomodulators that have an immunosuppressive effect. We will now move on to immunostimulatory drugs. These drugs are often used to treat conditions that suppress the immune system, but also just as commonly as a corrector to balance unintentional immune system suppression, for example, from some anti-cancer chemotherapy drug treatment. The other use these drugs have is in the treatment of some immune system-related cancers. Since the immune system can recognize some tumor cells and target them for apoptosis, some immune-stimulating drugs have anti-cancer properties. There are four main classes of immunostimulatory drugs. These are colony-stimulating factors, interleukins, interferons, and vaccines. In this tutorial, we won't discuss vaccines, as these have been discussed in more than one context in my tutorials on immunology, the history of drugs, as well as debunking content. So let's focus on the other three. Colony-stimulating factors act to enhance the production, maturation, and bone marrow release of various types of white blood cells into the blood. These factors are often present endogenously, but recombinant forms are sometimes given exogenously. By enhancing the overall count of white blood cells, it's easy to see how this general mechanism leads to immune system stimulation. Specific drugs in this class usually mediate their immunostimulatory effect by influencing the enhancement of a specific type of white blood cell. To give a brief example, filgrastim is a recombinant human methionine granulocyte colony-stimulating factor. It acts to enhance functionality of neutrophil progenitors via enhancement of production, maturation, and release into the blood. This class of immunostimulant is used to treat neutropenia, a condition characterized by a low concentration of neutrophils. This is often caused by a range of circumstances, for example, in patients receiving myelosuppressive chemotherapy, people suffering from AIDS, chronic B12 deficiency, as well as many other situations. Next, exogenous interleukins are sometimes used pharmacologically, such as oprelvacin and aldesleukin. These drugs are recombinant IL-11 and IL-2, respectively. As we touched on earlier when discussing immunophilin-binding drugs, interleukins are immune-stimulating chemokines. However, it is worth bearing in mind that recombinant interleukins, although sometimes helpful in some immunocompromised conditions, are mainly used in the clinic for some types of cancer, where immune function has been impaired either directly by the cancer, such as multiple myeloma, or indirectly via anti-cancer chemotherapy drugs. Finally, we can briefly discuss interferons. Interferons, like interleukins, are a large family of endogenous chemokines that are sometimes given exogenously for some viral infections, as well as some cancers, to enhance the immune response against viruses and tumor cells. The primary mechanism interferons elicit is through the interferon receptor located on the plasma membrane of most white blood cells. Following a complex intracellular signaling cascade, interferon regulatory factors are activated. These are transcription factors that increase the protein production of various immune-stimulating proteins, such as cytokines and proteins essential for the development and maturation of natural killer cells, B and T cells. In closing, it's important to appreciate the wide range of immunomodulatory drugs. The goal of this series is not necessarily to be totally exhaustive, but to cover commonly used drugs and important pharmacological mechanisms in such a way that, should you encounter other drugs in a particular class, you can apply the thematic understanding you gain from these tutorials to efficiently comprehend mechanisms of other similar acting drugs and how they achieve their pharmacological effect. And with that, we can now move on to an entirely different class of drugs.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.